Warning, this podcast has stories of real-life events and true crime that happens every day. These stories may contain adult language and graphic or disturbing details not suitable for everyone. Listener discretion is advised. In our society, most people are content to go through their daily lives safely and peacefully. But our society is not always safe or peaceful. For that reason, some men and women answer a higher calling to defend and protect their fellow man. You probably know someone who is one of these people, or maybe you are one of these people. The ones who see and do the things most people would never want to. These things are sometimes heroic and beautiful, but often they are horrific and terrifying. It's these things they don't share about with other people. It's these things they carry with them, so you don't have to. But when they get together, they talk to each other about them. And they call these stories war stories. Welcome to another episode of the War Stories Podcast. I'm Fletch Fletcher, your host. And as always, I'm the retired cop and the king of useless information. With me right now is my co-host, Zohan. What's up, dude?
What's going on?
Wipe that sleep from your eye, my little cubby bear. The reason we're recording this is because this episode that you're about to listen to, I had to record by myself via Skype with the host of the show Forged in Fire.
Because it could not wait.
We had him on the hook, and we were at the mercy of his schedule. So we recorded it via the internet. Wil Willis is a former Army Ranger and Air Force Pararescuemen. So he's done both duties. And it was interesting. He told us that he was never deployed in combat because, you know, as some of our guests are, they were part of Clinton's army. And so they had all this training and nowhere to go. But he had a real funny story about a very famous colonel who chewed him out naked.
The colonel or him?
Both of them.
Interesting.
Yeah, so we'll get you'll hear it. It's kind of funny that
also known as a sword fight.
Right.
Sorry.
So the fact that you can never get deployed and still have some great stories is a big part of military culture. But it's a good story. And then you'll hear as we bunny trail into the state of politics today and how that affects our fighting men and women, both who are deployed and those who don't deploy, and also our veterans as well. He has some strong opinions on that. So
awesome. It's going to be a good episode.
It is going to be a great episode. I just wanted to bring up that our challenge coin, and our challenge coin t-shirt is about to be released for pre-order. So hopefully by the time this episode comes out, we'll have the pre-order information available. You can PayPal, you can Venmo, you can go to your local police station and actually just...
Yeah, we're going to hand it out.
You're going to hand it out.
We're going to hand it out to all the subs. First of all, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Are you sure?
Absolutely.
I can't hear shit. Anyways.
Well, your ears might be a little...
Yeah, we're going to hand it out to all the local agencies and post it up. I've talked to a few people. So it's all going to get disseminated throughout Los Angeles. And the flyers will also be up on our Facebook, on our Instagram. It'll be blasted out to pretty much everyone we know.
Right, and our Instagram is at War Stories Official with underscores. Right. But if you just type in War Stories Official, you can find us. Same thing with Facebook. All the information will be posted there. So you can get that, and our the proceeds for, you know, beyond covering our costs, the proceeds are going to go to the Wounded Blue Foundation, which is a foundation that Randy Sutton told us about on our episode with him, for peer support for officers who are involved in critical incidents that maybe need, peer support, counseling, or financial assistance going through the aftermath of a critical incident. So, please check that out. Please check us out on Instagram. Like, subscribe, comment, share, tell your friends about us, because that's the way we grow the podcast. If you want to support and donate, please pre-order the challenge coin. It's only $20 if you pre-order. It's $25 if you get it after we release them. So you'll get a little bit of a discount for pre-ordering, and enjoy the episode with Wil Willis. Welcome to this special episode of War Stories. I'm your host, Fletch Fletcher. I'm the king of useless information and a retired cop, and I'm here with our special guest, Wil Willis, the host of Forge and Fire. What's up, my brother?
Not much, man. I'm living a blessed life. I feel pretty good. I like that your name is phonetic like mine, like Fletch Fletcher, and I'm Wil Willis. You know,
it's cool. It's, you know, very alert. What do you think? Yeah, well, I named myself. I took this nickname after a book character who's a complete and total smartass. And since I'm a complete and total smartass, I just Figured it would work, man.
Yeah, so you're, seems to happen to all of us.
Yeah, right. Especially if you served, it's a coping mechanism.
Yeah, yeah.
Speaking of serve, so you, we had you on the show, not just because I love the show Fortune Fire. I do love the show Fortune Fire. And it seems like you guys have a good time making it. And you guys actually like seem to have a real genuine camaraderie.
It depends on what's going on. And, you know, filming Fortune Fire is like a military deployment. You know what I mean? You know, none of us are from the area. You know, we're kind of put up in billets that are provided by, you know, the production company, which is great. Thank God. I mean, again, it's a blessing to have a great job. But it does take a long time to film. You are away from home. You don't, you know, you're living in a place with a bed. You know, it depends on what's going on any given moment. And by no stretch of the imagination am I complaining. I'm just saying, you know. Depends on what kind of mood we're in. We hang out with each other a lot.
Yeah, well, you guys are in a little bit. You know, you're not in a major metropolitan area when you film it, I guess, right?
Well, I mean, we're not. We're about 30 miles commuter town called Stamford.
Stamford, Connecticut. I've heard of that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Super nice.
Yeah, I'll bet. Well, Connecticut's, you know, not exactly a slouch place to visit, right?
Well, it's pretty humid out here. You know, the weather's starting to remind me of Fort Benning, and that just that's gonna kick off some ticks.
Yeah, Fort Benning's a different kind of weather entirely. I hear. I've never been there myself, but
the trip, a day off, and you take them back. The schedule is a little bit strange. You know, it's not a regular 5-day-a-week schedule. Some days you work, you know, some weeks you work 6 days, some weeks you work four. It's just, you know, kind of crazy. So it's hard to schedule anything. You can't get to a doctor's appointment. You know, I mean, there are problems with it.
Sure.
It's a great gig. We get along for the most part. God forbid we disagree about the weapons. Then it's a knockdown, drag out. You know, I'll show you mine. You show me yours. You know, kind of fight to the finish.
Wow, you guys, so that really, you guys will really like disagree about who's who in the zoo and who gets what and what's better?
I like to tell people that in season one, I used to stir the pot so badly between these judges, you know, just being the advocate for all the Smiths, that Doug Marquita threatened to go to his car and grab a sword and challenge me to a duel.
I believe that. I completely believe that. And he probably told you it will keel.
Yeah, no. He said, "I know my shit. Don't tell me my shit. I know my shit. I'll go to my car and I'll get my sword. We'll have a fucking sword fight right now." I said, "You don't have a fucking car here, so you go get your imaginary sword, and I'll grab my imaginary gun, and we'll freaking go at it."
That's awesome. How many episodes do you guys film? Like you do, you know, 3 hours for the first segment and 3 hours for the second segment. So that's like one day, right?
Well, the way that it's divided up really depends on the type of steel that we're using and the challenges that are at hand. You know, some steels take longer to temper, you know, so the episodes are divided up a little bit. They're all filmed in, as far as the forge goes, you know, the forging rounds, the first two rounds are filmed in 2 or 3 days.
Okay.
And then the guys come back, you know, the guys are sent to their home forges and then they come back for a finale. So all total, you know, as far as hours go, it's something like 250 to 300 hours of footage compressed down into 42 minutes. That's why we tell people, don't learn how to make a knife by watching Forged in Fire. They're leaving steps out. They have to leave steps out.
Yeah, it's not good TV.
Yeah.
So you ended up on the show, but you have a military background.
Yeah.
You were an Air Force brat. Right. I guess the bio information I read. So just so you know, there's bad internet information out there. Shocking. Who knew?
No, I can tell you. I mean, I was born on Lodges Field Air Force Base. I was an Air Force brat from birth. Lodges Field Air Force Base is in it's in the Azores, which are islands off the coast of Portugal. My mother was a foreigner. You know, my dad was a true blue military guy, married a foreign lady. You know what I mean?
As one does.
Old school kids. And then he brought us back to the United States, and my mother stayed in Europe. You know what I mean? And basically, my dad raised us for a period of time. You know, as Air Force, goddamn, we were feral. My poor dad, five of us.
Five, wow.
Yeah, man. I told my Uncle Mimi that we pushed the dresser over on my Yaya, who's, you know, Greek. You know, I was visiting Greece, and he said he didn't believe my Yaya when she said how terrible we were. But, you know, she left and she was healthy, and she came back to Greece. She was in a wheelchair, so we messed her up. We were vicious, too. Anyway, we lived on Air Force bases. My dad got remarried at some point, and then he retired out of Beale Air Force Base. I went to DOD schools all the way up until eighth grade. I did high school as, like, my first, like, you know, regular public school sort of compared to DOD schools and the attitudes. I mean, at least in DOD schools, all of the Air Force kids, you know, all of the military brats, all those little government brats, we all had that in common. So there was not – I didn't really experience anything like – I don't know. Other than like cliques, I never really experienced any what do you call that?
Bullying or
racism? No, racism. Bullying. Oh yeah, we bullied the hell out of each other. It was encouraged by our parents. You know what I mean? Like,
oh, I see.
Our parents were in the military. They're like, kick his ass.
Yeah, right.
Well, I didn't really experience anything like racism and stuff like that until I left the DOD school system. I don't think, as far as like at schools and stuff like that, maybe a little bit here and there, but like you were so protected as an Air Force brat, as a dependent, that I had a warped perception of the world.
Well, the military tends to do that, and being raised by the military tends to do it even worse, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, if you think about the Air Force, it was the first organization in the United States that was completely desegregated, and I think that happened in 1956, which is about, I don't know, maybe 54, 56, but it was almost a decade before, like, the whole movement.
Right, the civil rights movement and everything.
Right. So, you know, to grow up in a society, you know, it was fully integrated and everybody worked pretty well with everybody, and everybody at least had that common denominator. We didn't experience the same kind of, or at least my perception as a kid was that it was a big deal, that race was ever a big deal. I mean, shit, man, it didn't matter. As long as you could throw a ball, you're on the team. Ha!
Yeah, right.
You know, they see an objective, they see a team.
Right.
You know what I mean? They see, like, guys that got to keep each other safe and from harm while they execute their objective, and at the end of the day, man, I don't give a rat's ass, you know, what your sex, race, color, freaking creed, I don't care what your religion is, if you can do your job to the standard, fucking, you're on the team.
Right, we don't have a problem.
You can throw a ball, you're on the
team. Right, we don't have a problem. Exactly. So growing up then as an Air Force brat, then you decided to go into a branch of the military that was not the Air Force. Yeah.
Well, my big brother, he served in Desert Storm. He was a tanker.
Right.
He was with the Able Desert Storm, and you know, he got to get his, you know, he got to get it on a little bit, and he did a couple of years, and he got out, and you know, he said he really appreciated his VA benefits and stuff like that. And he went the law enforcement route. And then when it came time for me to figure out what I was going to do, I knew I wasn't going to go to college. I didn't have the attention span for that. School wasn't hands-on enough for me. I took 3 PE classes my senior year just so I wouldn't have to sit in a classroom and choke on rhetoric.
Right, right.
So I was working in landscaping, and I didn't think that I'd be able to escape Yuba City, California. And then, you know, my brother, he was like, look, man, I use the Army, but just be smart. Get a job that you could use on the outside. And at
right.
the time, the Air Force was telling me that I couldn't pick my job. You know, they're like, you can't pick your job. And in the Marine Corps, everybody, you know, was the same. And
right.
in the Navy, well, I don't like boats. I don't like boats. You know, it's not my thing.
Right.
So the Coast Guard and the Navy were out.
Right.
And I didn't want to be able for like 7 months, but then you know, after having been on some ships, I mean, it's a pretty cool gig. But I looked at the Army, and I was pissed off one day. I was really pissed. I was in the back of like concrete mixers with an air hammer in Northern California. It's like 103 degrees outside, and I'm like air hammering all this shit out. I don't have any Headgear Pro, and it's the 90s, bro. Like, you know, early 90s,
yeah, right.
too.
Safety third, right?
Yeah. I'm inhaling all this crap, and I crawl out of the bag of these things at the end of the day, and I drove straight to the recruiter's office. I said, you know what? If I'm going to get dirty, if I'm going to get it on, if I'm going to be subjected to, like, all this noise and muck and, like, misery, I was like, I might as well do it with a bunch of other guys that freaking want to just, like, put them, like, get it on.
Yeah, yeah.
And I went to work with the recruiter, and I was pissed. I was pissed. And I just something inside of me just really, and my son, he's 18 now. He's got the same thing. Just wanted to get it on.
Right.
Just needed to get it on. I don't know what it was, but I needed to get it on. It needed to come out.
Right.
I told this guy that I wanted to jump out of airplanes and shoot people in the face. And he said, have I got the job for you? He popped in like a VHS tape of the Rangers. I watched that VHS tape of, like, guys on Zodiacs zipping around, you know what I mean, like doing high-speed assaults, you know, doing Ranger shit. And I was like, hell yeah, that's what I want to do. I said, get me out of here ASAP. From the day I walked into that guy's office until I left for Fort Benning, it was, I think, 10 weeks.
Wow.
10 weeks. And I went into the Army on October 20th of 1993, 17 days after Mogadishu went down.
Wow.
Yeah.
We had a Marine sniper on, and he was there like 6 months before Mogadishu went down. And he was, you know, he's kind of one of those deals where he was pissed. He's like, man, if they'd have just left us there instead of letting the freaking UN handle it, we would have kept it handled.
I know the history of the operation pretty well, both from the Ranger point of view, from the pararescue point of view,
right,
and then also from the tactical emergency trauma care point of view, you know what I mean? Kind of like the after actions reports that came out of that really did define, you know, a lot of the ways that we did things in future operations, you know what I mean? But I showed up at 3rd Ranger, you know, it was 3rd Ranger Battalion that was in Mogadishu. And I showed up at that same battalion after basic, after airborne school, after RIP. I ended up being stationed with Alpha Company, 3rd Ranger Battalion. And they were recovering from all of that. So like 30 guys or 13 guys from my RIP class went with me to Alpha Company.
Wow.
And I think 5 of those guys went to the same platoon with me, and by the next morning, one of those guys had already quit. Said, I don't want to be at the. This is after basic, after airborne, after RIP, a one night in the Ranger Battalion, and this dude named Reed was like, I'm out. I'm out of here. Just freaking quit
was
the next day.
Just too tough, or he just didn't enjoy it?
Well, man, back in the days of hazing, bro.
You mean back when, you know, you actually could separate the wheat from the chaff properly?
I didn't sleep a wink my first night in the Ranger Battalion. I was up all night sewing like cat eyes on my PCs with unwaxed dental floss. I mean, the attention to detail and the shit that they made us do back in the 90s when we weren't at war was obscene, man. It was obscene. I can polish boots like nobody's business. I can march. I can run. You know, I mean, we did a lot of training, no doubt about it, but like the entire time I was at the Ranger Battalion, we trained up for Haiti, which got kanked literally while we were on the airplane.
Right.
And nothing else happened. And that was in 94. Nothing else happened. And I left in 98 because I knew PJs were actually doing stuff during civilian, you know, during peacetime.
Right. So that's Clinton's army. I've heard stories from people who served during the Clinton era, and it was like, yeah, you weren't going anywhere, period. End of story. So then you joined pararescue as a result of boredom, I guess?
Well, no, it wasn't really as a result of boredom. I had looked at pararescue before I went into the army, not knowing a whole lot of the details. My dad was a comm guy. He didn't fight my dad. You couldn't get my dad on an airplane, and he was in the Air Force. Hell no. He's not getting on an airplane. He's like, that's for officers. They go drop bombs, and if they come back, we give them more bombs and send them away again. My dad's perception of like how leadership should work is very like from the front. Leader should be right there in the front with everybody else.
Right. Yeah.
You know, and I agree with him. But and it brings me to my story, which brings me to my story. I mean, I did the pararescue thing, but my story is about leading from the front. It's about, you know, Ranger Battalion stuff. But anyway,
Well, real quick, before we get into it, can you tell the audience what Pararescue is? Because I don't think people understand, like, Pararescuemen are as elite. And when it comes to the Air Force, they're as elite as you can get, you know?
Pararescuemen recover down and injured air crew members in austere and non-permissive environments. Additionally, they provide rescue assets during peacetime catastrophic events such as Katrina.
Right.
And then in addition to that, they provide alternate landing sites for NASA missions, like it's called a TAL site. So when the space shuttle launches, if the astronauts have to bail out or abandon the mission in the middle, Pararescuemen are already in the sky with all the assets that they need to recover those astronauts and materials. They are search and rescue and recovery specialists. In addition to that, every Pararescuemen is a nationally registered paramedic, you know what I mean, who provides tactical emergency trauma care specialty at point of injury. You know what I mean?
So, right. Are you guys
It's pretty extensive search and rescue and recovery training, but on top of that, you should be the most medically advanced paramedic on the battlefield in any tick. You know what I mean?
Right. You got to be able to get in and get out. And then when you're there, you're not necessarily going into the friendliest of territories. So you got to be prepared to not only do a rescue, but do it under fire. And you got to be, you got to be just as deadly as you are life saving.
There are PJs that are attached to SEAL teams, that are attached to CAG teams, that are attached to SF teams out there. I mean, the career field itself is so selective, and the attrition rate is so high that at any given time, there's only about 250 to 300 pararescuemen on active duty. And I think all total throughout history, it's less than the number of Rangers that are serving right now.
You know
what I mean? That's how few pararescuemen have come through. And it is typically a career that guys ride for 10, 12, 20, 30 years, you know, because it is a very rewarding career if you can hang on through the turmoil.
Yeah, right. So that brings us to
politics. It is very cool.
Yeah, right. So that brings us to your story, man. Why don't you tell us what your story is?
All right. So my story, and this just kind of dates all the way back. It's my very first deployment as a Ranger. I was 19 years old, and in about mid-April 1994, we deployed to Avon Park out in Florida. And we were doing training. We were training up for this Haiti mission, right? So, I was brand new to the Ranger Battalion. I'd only been there for 2 weeks, and my roommate was, and I was E-nothing. I didn't even have any stripes on my collar, man. And I had to stand at parade rest for my roommate, who was PV2 Sears, right? Bradley Sears, if you're listening out there, I still love you, brother. But PV2 Sears, I would have to stand at parade rest. I stopped doing that after he puked on the floor one night. I was like, I'm not standing at parade rest for your ass anymore. But anyway, I was in third squad, 2nd Platoon, Alpha Company, 3rd Ranger Battalion, and man, I didn't do push-ups for any other squad. We were badasses, We were just like, after Mogadishu, man, everybody just wanted to get it on, and that's the frame of mind that I was in. So when we were down at Avon Park, we went out to do some individual training, and I was feeling high speed, and I jumped over a tree, and I punctured a hole in my hip. You know what I mean? Had to go see the doc. It looks like a gunshot wound, but it's like a massive hole, and I'm like, I'm good. Keep working, keep training, no big deal. Another night, we screw up on a jump, right? We screw up on a jump. I lost the machete on the jump. It came out of the scabbard. I showed up at the rally point. Somebody's like, Willis, give me that machete. And I was like, ha ha! Oh, shit. No machete. I had the scabbard.
Right.
No machete.
You're right.
That's a big thing. Our freaking assault went like crap. We go back. We get the after actions report, and the mission was a shit show. And then at about 4 o'clock in the morning, 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, we're doing like bayonet fighting techniques with live bayonets, like me and 3 other privates under the supervision of our older and more experienced squad leader and team leader. Right? And I end up getting slashed on my back, right? So I got to go see the medic again. And the medic is like, what the hell are you doing to these guys? Well, the next morning after that, we're in the shower tent, right? Everybody goes and takes a shower, and they had like, a big setup, you still got camo all over your face and crap, and you already feel like shit.
Right.
The mission, it's, and I go into the shower tent, and you know, you're like, it's just, you're 19 years old. There's a bunch of naked fucking men standing around fucking showering. You're like, right. You're just going to fall in line, you know, like prison, you know? I was like, all right, there's a lot of dick in here.
Right.
Right. I start showering up, right? I'm fucking trying to scrub all of this camouflage off of my face. And then somebody screams, Area 10, huh? So everybody snaps to attention in the freaking shower tent.
Naked, covered McKnight, in soap.
Yeah. You know, Somalia hero Colonel McKnight comes walking into the tent. And he's like, carry on. He kind of, makes his way across the whatever. You don't want to look at Colonel McKnight, you know what I mean? You're like, oh, it's Colonel McKnight. You're naked. He's naked. You don't want to see him like that.
Wait, oh, say, he was there for a shower.
I'm rubbing my head, and I'm kind of looking out of the side of my eye, and then my platoon sergeant is right there taking a shower. And he's a guy from Boston. I can't remember his name, but Colonel McKnight goes, hey, Sergeant First Class so-and-so, you got a kid in your platoon named fucking Private Willis? I'm fucking standing right there.
Oh, shit.
And my platoon sergeant goes, roger that, sir. He's right there. Fucking just points right at me. And I proceed to get the ass-chewing of my life from Colonel McKnight while he's butt naked, soap running into, shriveling up into my stomach. My fucking penis is in retreat. And then this dude is like right on me, and he's screaming about, like, it was an airfield seizure. We had an airfield seizure, and there's very specific places that you have to ground your parachute during an airfield seizure. And there was some confusion about, is it at the runway? Do we go to the wood line? Does it go 5 meters past the wood line? Is it on the wood line? You know, is it 5 meters away from the wood line? Because eventually these parachutes have to be picked up. It's completely a legit thing for, like, an airfield seizure. You don't want propellers to pick up the fucking parachute, so everything's packed away nice and tight. So I want to be first, man. I want to be first to the assembly area. I want to be the first private there. So I remember ditching my parachute on the wood line. I was like, okay, I'm not going to go in. I'm not going to back it off. I'm going to go for the middle on the wood line. I took off for the assembly area, and I was the first fucking private to be there without my machete. Remember this?
Right.
And Colonel McKnight comes running down the fucking wood line later on, like trying to get to his assembly area, and he eats shit. And he turns around, and he's fucked up, dude. Like, he was fucked up. His face was ragged. And he turns around, and back in the day, we used to put little cards on all of our parachutes.
Who's parachuting? No.
To what platoon, the whole nine. So he rips the bag tag off the head parachute, and he goes running to Alpha Company 2nd Platoon's assembly area. Now, when he gets there, and I remember this little man very upset, running around the platoon trying to do something, but my squad leader had just chewed my ass for, like, losing the machete, and we had to go bust brush. You know what I mean? So this guy is like, where's Willis? Where the hell is Willis? And I'm like, I'm right here, Sergeant. Because everybody's sergeant at night when you can't fucking see. And, you know, there's like one nod for the entire fire team. You know, one guy with a PDS-7. So I remember going to talk to this guy who's looking for Willis. And my squad leader grabbed me and said, Willis, we're fucking moving. I just hauled ass. Well, of course, I'm dragging my lowering line from my parachute. And this dude gets hung up in my lowering line. I fucking snatch it, and I drop him on his ass again. And I just take off running.
By accident, not knowing, right? You don't know you did this?
I had no idea any of it was Colonel McKnight until the next day when he was knee-deep in my soapy ass. Just getting it, man. Like, it was horrible, dude. Horrible. And that is my Colonel McKnight. He was on the freaking ground, leading from the front, and I fucked him up.
That'll teach a colonel to go out and seize an airfield, right?
You know what? It teaches attention to detail, you know what I mean?
Right.
And it's the attention to detail. Like, look, man, like, if a worse thing could have happened, he could have tripped over that parachute and landed on a freaking punji stick for all I know. You know, I mean, it's just like, you know, it's really one of those things where I think it was the first time that I ever really realized that every detail of what I do matters to the mission overall.
Right.
Even as the low-ranking guy, something that you do or fail to do in this case could have an effect on that you don't even know about, a ripple effect. You know what I mean?
Right.
So you end up treating every detail of your job like it's life and death. And this is where guys have problems
right.
when they get out of the military, because you were taught that every detail of your job is life and death, because it is.
Yeah.
It because can. It is.
Absolutely.
Yep. Somebody else's life relies on you making sure that that closing loop is done correctly for a parachute jump. Somebody else's life relies on your weapons maintenance. You know what I mean? So when you're taught that everything that you do is life and death, it's hard to transition away from that.
Yeah, you know, it's funny because even, you know, you compare, we've had a lot of people on in the military, going to the police academy, people that have done both. You know, one of the concepts that they tell you is you may have an explanation for why something happened, but that don't mean it's an excuse, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, you just explained why your line was out there and this colonel ate shit on it, but the colonel didn't care because that doesn't excuse what you did. And I think when we talk about, you know, things on the show, we talk about you know, actions have consequences, and it's amazing mm-hmm. how the military and any kind of, you know, military service, police service, fire service, they teach you that you may not understand why the rule exists, but someone right. does, and it exists for a reason. And it's, so it's right. always that your actions have consequences to other people.
Yeah. You know, and it's something that accountability is something that we're taught in the military. I still reflect on like the 11 principles of leadership. Seek responsibility, take responsibility for your actions. That's one of the 11 principles of leadership that I learned that maybe I take to a little bit of an extreme. I can let some of that go. But when I was in the military, man, I wanted to be in charge. I wanted to be the jump master. I wanted to be the guy that made the whole plan come together, because I knew if I did it,
it was done right.
Then I wouldn't, you know, it would be done right, or that the details wouldn't be overlooked, the details that I thought mattered. And it was good and bad in a lot of ways. One, it taught me to step up and make things happen. But it, on the other hand, I didn't trust other people. You know what I mean? And getting out of the military, I trusted civilians even less. You know?
Right, so, right, exactly.
And there was this expectation that they understand, you know. And then somebody finally told me, like, dude, you're driving a taxi cab. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but you know what?
Like, what you're doing is life and death for your passenger. Yeah, absolutely. But, like, let's not make it sound like there's some ripple effect for you driving a cab that's going to affect everything else in the world, you know. So it was hard for me to kind of let go of my own ego a lot when I transitioned out of the military, you know. So
that's one of those big things too, is for people who are transitioning out of law enforcement, transitioning out of the military, for our listeners out there, you know, there's a lot of you who are listening that did serve. And one of the reasons this podcast exists is so you can feel like you're not alone and feel connected and go, yeah. That's what I went through. But one of the things that we keep hearing over and over is when you transition out, you have this expectation of the people around you, right? Because you're mm-hmm. in this environment, you're in this military or police or whatever environment, fire environment, where everybody is trained to a certain standard. Everybody operates up to that standard, and if you don't operate up to that standard, they're going to cut you, and they're going to, you know, they're just going to leave you behind. So when you get to the civilian world and you get to a regular job and you run into these office problems where somebody should be taking accountability for their actions and they're not, or you know, an operation, there's so many cooks, there's, you know, too many chiefs, not enough Indians, and you want to step forward and say, okay, everybody shut the fuck up. I'm going to just, let me tell you how it's going to go. And you're seen as a.
Yeah. And that's exactly what people don't want.
Right. Right.
Like, here's the thing. I feel bad for our veterans. I feel bad for our law enforcement. I feel bad that if for anybody that comes from any sort of government structured leadership or organization, you know what I mean? I really do, because you know what we're instilling in our veterans, what we're instilling in law enforcement, is this sense of preservation of the greater, of everybody else, of the community, of right. the country, whatever. You know, we're fed this line that like what you're doing is for the good of everybody, and we're holding you to this standard.
Right.
You know what I mean? You have to be honorable. You have to, you know, you got to be somebody that people are going to look up to. You got to, you know, you got to check all these blocks if you're going to be that. You got to be our best and brightest to be a veteran, right? But then you get out of the military and you find out nobody gives a shit.
Yep.
And that's fucking hard, dude. And when I say nobody gives a shit, I mean fucking nobody gives a shit. Your fucking politicians don't give a shit. Your friends, they don't care. You know what I mean? The people that you end up going to college with or working with who never experienced the military or service in any way, they don't care. They say thank you for your service because it's easy.
Right.
But they shouldn't be thanking you for something that you volunteered to do in the first place. Don't thank me. Stand up for the national anthem. It's the least you that we do. Ask you to do. The absolute least you need to do to say I'm proud to be an American is stand up for the flag that represents fighting against injustice. You're going to kneel for justice because you feel like you're fighting against injustice? I mean, stand up for that. Stand up for that. That's what that flag represents. Stand up for that. Put your hand over your heart. You're not saying a prayer.
Yeah.
Just say, hey, man, thank you very much. I appreciate that. You don't have to thank me for my service. I didn't give the American people the freedoms that they have. You know what I mean?
You just stood up for them.
Thank me for your Chinese goods or whatever. whatever we're getting out of our current conflict, thank me for that. You want to thank somebody from World War II for their service, dude? I mean, they liberated Auschwitz. They tore down tyranny. Our guys now, they went in. They took down the Taliban. We killed Osama bin Laden. We freaking enforced all of this policy. You know, we had all of this sentiment behind us when we initially started, and all that shit went away.
Yep.
Nobody cares, dude. Nobody cares, and politicians don't care, and we got to start looking at taking care of ourselves. Other veterans care, your family members care, because those are the people that are going to be constants in your life. They either went through it with you, or they freaking love you because they have to.
Yep, and you got to rely on those people. Yeah. Well, you know, it's interesting you bring up the flag, because I had this conversation with somebody recently where, you know, we all saw the big flap about the women's team at the World Cup. And I don't know if anybody saw it, but, you know, as of the recording of this episode, our women's national team won the 2019 World Cup championship. And at the end, when they're celebrating, there's three gals. One of the gals apparently has an issue with the person in the Oval Office right now. That's her business, and that's her right to have an issue with him. I don't care about that. But one of the other gals is holding the flag, right? She's holding the Star Spangled Banner, and I take that shit seriously. And I
just put on lipstick. I did.
I love it. So she's holding this flag, and again, you see a national team, you see the Olympics, you see, hell, Rocky, you know, they wrap themselves in the flag and they have this this national pride.
Absolutely.
And so this gal's got it in her hand. I don't have a problem with that. But when her and two other gals start mugging for the camera and for the press and doing their war face and celebrating the victory, whether it's due to inattention or whether it's due to carelessness or whether it's deliberate, I don't know. But one of the gals drops the flag on the ground. And I don't know a person alive who doesn't understand the rule, you never let the flag touch the ground, right? So another gal behind her reaches up and snatches it up off the ground. And that's when she kind of, you know, oh, shit. And she grabs it and then she hands it off or whatever. And the conversation we got into with this other gal, she says, well, you know, it was just an honest mistake. Why are you so mad about it? And I said, because I'm disappointed. I said, you know, I expect better from people. She goes, well, what do you mean? I said, when I hold the flag, I treat it as if I'm holding a newborn baby. It's, you know, it's sacred. I'm terrified anytime I hold a flag.
It has a different meaning to you and to me.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, to me, this is something that symbolizes what my father's life stood for, what my life stood for a period of time. I mean, you're really in the military for 20 to 30 years. You know?
Right,
it's a fraction of your life. You know what I mean? But it is a very informative period of your life. And you know, what that flag means, it's something that's going to be draped over my casket.
Right.
It's been draped over the casket of my friends. It'll be draped over my father's casket. It'll be folded and handed to my wife when I die. You know what I mean? It symbolizes my willingness to give something of myself to my country. Right, not to my government,
right,
but to my country and my fellow countrymen.
And there's a difference.
Means. To everybody else, you know, it's just something, you know, that they fly and they say the Pledge of Allegiance, maybe. You know what I mean? It doesn't. It's not the same thing. It doesn't have the same sort of symbolism for them. So, you know, I appreciate our First Amendment right to do whatever we like, but it's also my right to, like you said, be disappointed. I could be disappointed in the representatives of my country, just like I'm disappointed in the politicians of our country.
Yep.
Here's my bigger issue with this whole flag thing. I'm disappointed. Sure, that's her burden to bear. That's her thing. She denigrated the celebration and the victory by doing that.
Yeah, she tainted it.
She has to live with that. She's got to wake up in the morning every day and say, have I done my absolute best? And sometimes we fall, man, and you get back up and you keep going. So I tell Rangers all the time, Rangers lead the way until we don't lead the way. And then we just Ranger on.
Right.
You know what I mean? Sometimes it's just head down, one foot in front of the other, just moving, following the people in front of you. And sometimes you lead the way. All right. The ideal is that you're always doing that. She made a mistake. She's entitled to that mistake. She didn't even make a mistake, dude. It's her First Amendment right to do that.
Yeah.
But it's her action to live with. My bigger question is like, okay, that's great. Where's the money?
Right.
Where's my tax dollars going? I don't give a fuck about that. That's just something for people to talk about. Where are my tax dollars going? How come Congress isn't wearing chest cams?
Right.
How come there's not cameras in every office in Congress so that we can start to monitor our government and
right.
these thieves and what they're doing? Like, I don't care about the American flag. I don't care about Blue Lives Matter, Black Lives Matter. I don't care about any of that because all those are problems that are never going to be solved with our tax dollars.
Right.
I mean, those are problems that exist in the mind. Those are perceptions. Let's talk about problems that we can solve with our taxes. I want to know where all that money is going. Like,
right.
I'm tired of news that about perceptions and things that are distractors from real fucking problems that the American people have. All right? Where is our money going?
Right.
Billions of tax dollars. It's not going to health insurance because I know I pay a shitload of health insurance and I can't use my health insurance because I work in a state other than what I reside. Why is that like it is? And why can't I change insurance plans in the middle of the year? Why is it set up to rob the American people? Why? Where's all the money, man? Where's the
right,
money?
Right.
I want to know where the money is.
Yeah.
Let's start following the money and start solving some real problems. I don't care about all of this other crapola, dude. Like, our country is a capitalistic system of government built for commerce and prosperity for everyone. For everyone.
Yep.
Everyone deserves to prosper. But when you're being taxed at 38%, 48%, 50%, where's the prosperity? And I want to know where that money is going. And why do military members pay taxes on tax dollars that they're paid with?
Right?
Right? And where's the money going?
And if we have all this money, why can't we get a VA that can effectively treat and serve our veterans?
Why can't a veteran walk into any hospital in the country, regardless
right.
of it's a VA hospital or not, and be treated?
Right.
Why?
Why
is the government augmenting health? Why does the government have to help pay for health insurance? Why?
Right.
People can't afford health insurance, man. That's a problem.
Right.
Most people have either their job augmenting their health insurance, what they pay in personally, or they have the government augmenting that. Me, I pay full price, and I can't even use it.
Yep.
Because I'm not working in the state that I reside in.
It's insane.
That's a problem, dude. These are real problems that we need to talk about. We need to follow the money. We need to find the problems. And we need to start fixing those problems. Border patrol, border security, all that. My mother was a foreigner. I have sympathy for that.
Right.
I really do. But there is a process that must be engaged in. My own mother didn't engage in that process. She never became an American citizen.
Yep.
Sorry, Mom. It freaking sucks. But you got to go through the process.
I have
a lot of really strong opinions about
this. Yeah, no. I'm the firstborn son. My sister and I are, and my brother are the firstborn in this country. My mother was a foreigner. She came here and she got her citizenship, and my aunt never did. Right. So
right.
They'll talk, and occasionally my aunt will bring up politics, and she'll complain about the government, and I'll say, you don't get to complain. You're a guest here. My mom applied for citizenship. She has a vote. She has a voice. When you want to apply for citizenship and have a vote and have a voice, then you can fucking complain.
You know, I think that it's like, I don't care if people complain about the United States. That's fine. I've traveled all over the world. I've been to other places, and there are other countries that are great. I don't know that I would want to live permanently anyplace else. There's just too much to do here. There's 50 states that are the size of any other country.
Right.
You know,
right.
We've got countryside. We've got great cities. We've got great environment out there. Anybody that's saying that they live in the city because they have to live in the city is out of their minds. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, move out of the city. Move out to the country. Explore the United States, dude. Anybody that's saying that the opportunities aren't there and they have to live off the government tip, that's because they haven't left whatever freaking place that they're in right now. They haven't just – like, it doesn't cost that much to go to a different town and get a job in a different town.
No.
It really doesn't, man. Like, people can be – I think the American people need to be reinvigorated.
Right.
They need to be reinvigorated. They need something that's going to make them proud of themselves again. Right. And it's going to be fighting. It's not going to be fighting wars. We're good at that. We got the baddest ass gang on the planet.
Right.
No doubt about it. We really do. And I'm happy that I was a part of that gang, and it's amazing. But, like, we need something that we can really grab onto and say, man, I'm proud to be an American, because this is what we can do. We can change our country.
Yeah.
We can.
Yeah.
We can change our country. All of these laws, all of these BS laws that are just about theft, that are just about stealing from the American people and putting it in the pockets of politicians and other corporate freaking bigwigs, all of these things we can make go away, man, but we don't. We'd rather complain about it, because it takes effort. Exactly. It takes effort to make change. It takes more than a tweet.
Yeah.
All right? It takes more than a tweet. It takes action. And it takes people who can see past all of the discrimination.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Got to be able to see past that. You got to be able to see discrimination for what it is. Discrimination is a distractor from the real problems that we have. You know what I mean? Anytime that somebody wants to talk about job disparities, income disparities, whatever, they want to talk about discrimination. You want me to tell you why the female soccer players don't make as much as the male soccer players do? It has nothing to do with discrimination.
No.
It has to do with sales.
Yep. They don't bring in as much money.
That's it, man. You bring in the revenue, you make the money. Ask Sandra Bullock, man. She makes $20 million a picture, as she used to. All right?
Right.
And there are a lot of dude actors who weren't making that kind of money.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? If you bring the revenue, you'll make the money. It's the same with the NFL. We can complain about the money that these guys make all day long, but they're bringing it to the house.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like, that's reality. Equal pay is for equal work.
Right.
And equal work means I don't care if you played the 90 minutes. I don't care if you played the 90 minutes 10 times harder than a guy. If you didn't bring the fans, if you didn't bring the revenue, if you didn't bring the advertisers, then you're not going to get paid the money. I know that.
Right.
I'm the most overpaid TV show host. No, I'm kidding. But, like, you know what I mean? Like, here's the thing. I'm not making what Ryan Seacrest is making because I'm not bringing that kind of revenue in. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
But, I mean, I love it. It's a blessing, but that's the reality. And that's what people need to grab onto, man. Like, you'll get paid what you're worth, but it's about money. It's right. always about money. Anything else is a distraction from the money.
And that's a common thread you see among people in the military and people in public service, is they understand the I guess, for lack of a better word, sacrifice, the effort that needs to go into making something good. You know, everybody wants to argue about diversity. Everybody wants to argue about this and that. Well, diversity is great. Look at the military. The military is super diverse. Church groups, super diverse. Church groups and the military work because the diversity is a strength when everyone is facing the same direction and everybody is working for a common goal, right?
Right.
So a church group or a military group, they all have a common belief. They have a common goal. They have a common objective. And, you know, like you said, if you can throw the ball, you're on the team. That's the way the military works. Well, if people would understand, if people would get that military mindset, I'm all for compulsory military service when everybody turns 18, just like the IDF does. I'm all for it because you.
I don't know about that, man. There's 300 million Americans, bro.
but I'm seriously all for it, and I don't care if it's military service in combat or if it's military service, and then they use those people to go work at hospitals or they go you know.
I'm down for compulsory service.
Yeah.
But it doesn't have to be military.
I think that there are jobs
in the government sector that could be turned over to compulsory service individuals.
Yep.
Somebody that's coming in to do a 4-year tour at the DMV.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Like you're going to do a 4-year tour at the DMV. You're going to work for your government, and this is how you're going to do it. You're going to do a 4-year tour working for Parks and Recreation.
Right.
You're going to do a 4-year tour, whatever. Like, I don't care about military service, but I do believe in serving your community.
Right. I guess that's a better word for it, just compulsory service.
Yeah, compulsory service to your community.
Right.
All right. And then that way, everybody can learn to appreciate, like, man, it sucks when I have to pick up somebody else's trash off the street.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
And I think that that is something that induces pride, you know what I mean, in your community and in your country, you know, when you have to work for it's like, I don't know, it's like anything else, man. Like, you had pride in your high school because that's the high school you went to.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
The military gives you an identity. It gives you a group to be a part of. It gives you, and that's what we're all looking for. We're all looking for that, you know, that sense of belonging, and that's what's great. And that's one of the things people miss mm-hmm. when they leave the military is, you know, we had a guy on who talked about
it. You're not going to find it unless you go into law enforcement.
Yep. Yep. Some sort and any kind of service.
I found a documentary a few years ago. I was having a little bit of trouble with my own transition. I was already filming a TV, and that is a topsy-turvy sort of turn of profession.
Right.
And I had done a couple of shows before, but I always stayed in contact with the military. I was a contractor, so, you know, I still kind of had that connection. When I started filming Forged in Fire full-time, man, I had a really rough time. I was living in a hotel by myself most of the time, and I had to be by myself most of the time. I couldn't go out and get hammered because I got to be on camera the next day. It wasn't about working the next day. I just couldn't look like hammered dog shit the next day. And I don't wear makeup. I don't do any of that stuff. It's weird. It was like I had to spend a lot of time alone with myself.
Right.
And I didn't deploy. You know what I mean? I'll tell anybody. I didn't go to Afghanistan. I didn't go to Iraq. But I was a military free fall jump master. And I did point the way a few times. And I do have a few jumps to my possible death under my belt. And I do have an entire lifetime of military service.
Right.
Military reliance.
Right.
Government reliance on the military as a dependent. And then again, as a military serviceman myself, and even as a contractor.
Right.
So when I finally had to live with, like, on my own and figure out how to do what everybody else in America seems to just know how to do, it was a rough turn for me, man. And I filmed a documentary, and I drove a motorcycle across the country, and I talked to other veterans. And I talked to other people, and it hit me in Denver, Colorado, when I went to a Ranger breakfast. The only people that care are military veterans and their families.
Yeah.
That's it, man. Everybody else, military veterans freaking care about the veteran. Their families care about the veterans. If you had a family member who was a veteran, you might care. If you serve your community, you might care. But everybody else just doesn't care.
No.
It doesn't affect them. It's not on their radar. And here we are, literally giving our lives, limbs, and our young men and women, hyper-motivated men and women, over to this service that nobody cares about. And I can prove it to you, man. I went to the Warrior Games a couple weekends ago. Took my son there who wants to be a Ranger.
For the ones who don't know, what are the Warrior Games?
The Warrior Games are it's basically wounded warriors, Army, Navy, Air Force, Marine Corps from all over the world competing in Olympic style events.
Right.
And oftentimes they're dealing with, or they're all dealing with, some sort of what do you want to call it?
Combat disability, right.
Yeah. Combat-related disability, whether it's PTSD, right, whether it's the loss of a limb, eyesight, whatever. I took my son to this, okay? And these are warriors from all over the world, mind you. And he's in Tampa, Florida. Big college. Went there. Watched the races, watched the track and field events in the morning. I walked my son to the far end of the field, and I had him turn around and look at the stands. This is something that's done once a year for these guys, once a year. How many people you think were there? How many people you think were in Tampa, Florida?
I can't even imagine.
Maybe 400 or 500.
Yeah.
Maybe 400 or 500, and that's being generous.
Yeah.
And they were all the friends and family of the people that were competing. I didn't know anybody that was competing. I was there because I'd been invited before. I was there because I happened to be in Tampa with my son who was thinking about going into the military. And I took him down there and I turned him around and said, look, son. I said, these guys are fucking amazing. They're in a bad way, and here they are freaking showing warrior spirit, and they're freaking competing, and I love them for it, and it's amazing, and it's a fucking awesome thing for us to be out here supporting these guys. I was like, but where the hell is everybody else?
Yeah. Don't thank them for their service. Go to the Warrior Games.
Where are the rest of the American people who thank these guys for their service? Where are you?
Right.
No. You're at a football game. They're at a baseball game. They're at some other event supporting some other freaking thing because it's a holiday weekend, and watching somebody with an amputation run down the track, somebody that served your country, somebody that gave up their leg for your foreign policy, watching somebody do that is too much for the American people to take responsibility for. They'd probably rather say, not my president, and absolve themselves of any responsibility whatsoever. And that's wrong. And that's not the American way either.
No, and you bring up a good point, because anybody who disrespects the flag or disrespects, the flag isn't one man, right? So the guy who's sitting in the Oval Office right now isn't the flag. The flag represents every single one of us, right? It represents me. It represents you. It represents every single one of those athletes who's had a combat injury.
Absolutely.
And so when you disrespect, it's not a protest against one politician to disrespect the flag. It's disrespecting yourself. It's disrespecting your fellow citizens. It's disrespecting 300 million Americans,
yeah,
just because,
exactly,
you're pissed off,
exactly,
at one guy. And so, you know, don't disrespect those veterans. Don't.
Exactly. Exactly. You know, and here's the thing. You've got a lot of people out there who are like, I didn't vote for war. I didn't do this. I didn't do that. And that's great, man. Maybe you didn't, but your representatives did.
And those guys
that represent your freaking beliefs, your cause, the people that you vote for, they voted on your behalf.
Yeah. Well, I think that's
they're there to submit the vote that you can't submit.
It's a representative government, brother.
And you don't want to take responsibility for that either. Another problem we have is that we have a government that has no oversight. There is no oversight for our government right now. There is no committee that can come in and say, we're going to freaking RICO Act this entire freaking section of Congress. You know what I mean?
Yep.
We're going to RICO Act the House Arms Committee. We're going to RICO Act we all know it, and no one's to say it. I'm scared of like these old men with gray hair who don't have progressive ideas. They're just hanging on to the little bit of empire that they have, man. And we're a revolutionary country.
Yep.
We were born in revolution, man. We want answers. We revolt. That's what we do. We are the misbehaving children of misbehaving children of
right.
misbehaving children.
Right.
All right? We will not tolerate theft. We right. will not tolerate oppression. The American right. people won't do it. I won't do it.
No.
I'm not having it anymore. And I'm going to start pointing fingers at people. I'm going to yep. say, you, I don't care. I don't care. You can say whatever you want about me. I don't care.
Yep.
You know what I mean? I own my shit. That's at least I learned that in the military. I have lived a gnarly, rugged life, man. I lived every day like I was going to die tomorrow.
Yep.
I'm proud of it. And there are things that I can't undo that I did that I had to freaking learn to live with. There were apologies that have been made. You know what I mean? But at the end of the day, I own my shit.
Right.
And like, I'm not out to wreck anybody else's life. I'm not out to oppress anybody. I'm not out to point fingers to say, you can't do this because of the color of your skin, or this is happening to you because of the color of your skin. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, I'm not out to, I want to know, like, why we're not all prospering, everybody.
Right.
Why aren't we living in that country that we established?
Right.
You know what I mean?
I
want the country that Thomas Jefferson envisioned.
Yep. And if you're not going to give it to us, we're going to take it back. Yep.
You know, I think a lot about politics, and I think a lot about like what it means to be a straight shooter. You know what I mean? Are there straight shooters in politics anymore? Are there guys that can come in and say, no, that's wrong, this is wrong, and start like doing the right thing without being taken down, without the snakes and villains coming out of the woodwork to throw somebody under the bus? And I'm not saying Donald Trump is that guy. Okay, not what I'm saying. And I'm not saying that a politician on the spectrum right now that is that guy. But we need somebody who's going to step up and start pointing fingers and say, there's nothing at Area 51. It's for, you know, it's for testing aircraft.
Government.
It's government. I've been to Tonopah, Nevada, man. I went there for Stinger Missile School. There's fucking nothing out there, man. Yep. And if there is, I don't care. We got bigger problems, okay?
Right.
Bigger
problems. Yeah. If you had to pass on, then I think we've just about covered it. But
we skewed it to politics, man.
No, it's a cool. Because as a veteran, you know, like I said, the war stories, especially for guys who signed up to serve and then didn't get to go to war sometimes, you have a takeaway, right? You have a takeaway from your time in the service. And it sounds to me like, well, I'll let you say. So what is the key that you would say is your takeaway from your time in the service that would carry you through the rest of your life?
My key takeaway from my time in the service is I served for me. I didn't serve for anybody else. I went into that recruiter's office and I said, I want to get it on. And he said, if I got the job for you, and he pointed me in the right direction, but I took all of those steps to get there. I went through all of the selections. I went through all of the assessments. I went through all of those processes to become what I became in the military. I didn't achieve everything that I wanted to achieve. I didn't get to deploy in the military. But I'm proud of what I did in the military. You know what I mean? I lived a life less ordinary.
Right.
Now that I'm not in the military, that's something that I have in my past, but it also informs the hard times now. I was in the military for 14, with some breaks in service, almost 15 years.
You know what I mean?
It's all divided up.
Yeah.
From 93, basically, until 2008. And before that, my dad was in the military. So, it's its own world, but it's not America.
Right.
You know what I mean? Military isn't America, dude. It is a government institution.
Right.
Where, you know, you march to the beat of the same drum, and you're forced to march to the beat of the same drum, or you're out, dude. You're out.
Right.
You know, and most of us there, we march to the beat, you know, to the beat of the collective drum, and we leave. Well, there's no drum beat anymore when you leave.
Right.
You have to establish your own drum beat, and you got to freaking march to that beat. If it's similar to what the beat of the drum you had in the military, that's great. If it's a whole new beat, like my freaking beat is funk. It's straight funk now. Okay?
Right.
Before it was Philip Sousa, and now it's just funk. You know, I got James Brown in the beat of my drum now.
So, right.
But you learn how to move forward. Always move forward. Move past things. Overcome adversity. Overcome obstacles. Problem solved, and you always do it in a team in the military. I don't know what the hell makes us think that we can do this shit without a team when we get out, But there's phone calls, there's Skype, there's text messaging, there's family, there's friends. And even if you don't think you have any family or friends, go to the VA. You'll make some friends, man. You'll all complain together.
Yeah.
And you'll have that in common. You know what I mean? It's about finding family. It's not necessarily the family you had before you left. You got to find your family now.
Right.
And your family is going to be different.
Right.
It's going to be different. Accept it and fucking continue to move forward. Be a leader, man.
Yep. And I think this country needs that leadership. So, man, would you come back? Would you come back on the show another time? Maybe if you're in LA, we'll take you around.
Yeah, man, I'll come back.
Okay, cool.
I'll come back when I announce my candidacy for president of the United States.
Hey, you know,
I start smacking people.
You got my vote. All right. Well, I appreciate you coming on, man, and I look forward to having you back. Once again, as we always say on War Stories, come home with your shield or on
anything incriminating.
No, you didn't.